Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Waterford Baptist Cathedral, whether you're joining us online or you're here in person. I'd just like to remind everybody to silence their cell phones in here. And we're going to sing a couple songs. I invite you all to stand and sing with me.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole world with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. All that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. The nations with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear. You would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Back up the men's and women's Bible study after a year and a half hiatus. We'll meet at 10 o'clock for study, have a little bit of a fresh refreshment at 9:30, and a little meet and greet, and hope to see you there. We've got a use in reading, and then we'll ask Brother Jim to come and open us in prayer. I am who the Bible says I am in Christ. I have what the Bible says I have in Christ. I can do what the Bible says I can do in Christ. And by the grace of Almighty God, I will walk by faith and not by sight. Seems like you were just up here last week, doesn't it?
You're missing out.
He's got camping on the mind, that's what it is.
Yeah. I'm on vacation already.
Good morning, everybody.
Hi.
Good to see each and every one of you here. Happy 4th of July to you. Don't shoot fireworks off in your face and stuff like that.
Don't
shoot a finger. Full of racism.
My dog just hates the fireworks.
Yeah, oh, he kept me up last night.
Every time one goes off, he's got to bark. Got to bark. He's got to bark. So, yard sale. Oh, I'm so glad it's over with. But it's not over with for me yet. So, I've still got things going on, and I did sell a couple more things, and I took a couple loads of scrap metal to the recycle centers, and so I've got an additional number. It's a revised number, we'll call it, on where we're at right now. We're at $16,258 now, so... best sale ever. Mm-hmm. And we're going to have a real hard time topping that. But who knows? God is good.
All the time.
I'm game to try to top it.
You what?
I said I'm game to try to top it.
Yeah.
God can do it.
Yeah. So, yeah, I put a couple things online that didn't sell in the yard sale, but I sold them for a little bit more than we had them out here sitting in the parking lot. So, I'm glad to see them gone. So, I got one more thing I got listed. Well, I got several things listed, but I got one more thing. I got a mower that I'm looking to offload, and we have to wait and see if that happens or not. But and got the paintings that I spoke of a couple weeks ago. I've got a spot up in Ortonville. I'm going to stop, and they're going to look at them and tell me whether or not they're worth anything. So I'm going to drop those off after I get back from vacation, and so maybe we can get some more money. So just never know. Money, money, money. Mr. Krabs. You have a question?
No, I just wanted to say thank you all for all your time, all you guys. You did a lot of work. Pastor, everyone.
Well, like I've said... What?
It was a fun week.
It was a fun week, yes. A lot of good fellowship, and got to meet a lot of very interesting people, and I hope we impacted the community. I don't see anybody impacted out here, but we've handed out a lot of connection cards, so I certainly hope that it impacted somebody somewhere along the way there. So, okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for this beautiful 4th of July day, and thank you, Father, for our freedom here in this country. And Father, we know that you are so very good, and we came over here into this country to be free from the rules from Europe. And Father, we know that we're over here that we do have the freedom. We have the freedom to... come in, and whether we choose to praise you or choose not to praise you. And Father, I pray that the majority would be the praise you. And but boy, has it been tough. And Father, we know that if people would just turn to you, Father, that things would be so much better in this country. But It's up, that's why you give us the decision on whether, what direction we want to go. And Father, I pray that we impacted some people during the sale, and they've changed their lives. And Father, I pray that you also be with, this morning, be with Jason as he continues to lead a couple more songs and do a couple more songs, and be with our pastor as he delivers the morning message. And keep us all safe as we celebrate this 4th of July. Be with us for the remainder of the day. We ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
We're doing a little extra up, down, up today. We've got one song here, and we're going to introduce a new one. So I invite you to stand and sing the first song, and then we'll give you a little bit of a break, and then we'll stand and sing another, sing it again. So.
I know that you are good.
About the time that the children of Israel spent in slavery to Egypt, they were in slavery to Egypt for over 400 years, longer than we have been a nation. And yet we can see how just as God worked through the nation of Israel throughout the history as recorded through his word, we can also look back and see how God has worked through America, allowing us to become the land of freedom and the land of liberty, a land that is a bastion and a lighthouse to the rest of the world, or the rest of the oppressed of the world, that they might come and find the opportunity for freedom of religion and the opportunity to pursue life and happiness and all of those kinds of things. Things that they were perhaps not allowed to do in the nations which they came from. And we don't see as much of an influx today, though maybe the borders are kind of like that, depending on how closely you're following all those things. But nothing like the influx of immigrants that took place back in the early 1800s and early 1900s as the immigrants came to this country in order to begin to work the farms and to work the factories and to make America who it is today. One of the remaining superpowers in the world, and certainly there are other nations that are rising as superpowers closely behind us today. But today we begin a brand new series. Today we begin a series that's entitled Temporary Versus Eternal. And so for the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at things that are temporary and things which are eternal. And in today's message, we're going to specifically be looking at Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. And we're going to be looking at the history of the nation of Israel and the history of God's interaction with that nation and how we can apply the truths that we learned there to our own lives here today as well. So I am Daryl. I'm the pastor here at Waterford Baptist Cathedral, and we just want to say welcome to everyone who's here in person, those of you who are watching online. buckle up, because this is going to be a fast-moving message. I'm not sure we're going to get through it all today. It's covering a lot of territory, but we'll get as far as we can, and then we'll just keep going for however many weeks the Lord allows us to keep going with it. Amen? So we're going to stop, and we're going to pray first of all, and then we're going to get right into the message. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for establishing this word in my heart. Thank you for allowing me to do the background study, not only on America's history, but also on the history of the nation of Israel as recorded through your word and through the history books, and to learn the lessons that hopefully you will teach us to apply to our lives here today. I present myself to you, Lord. I'm just your servant. I ask you to anoint me. I ask you to place your words within my mouth and within my heart so that as we speak them, they will be your words going forth. I pray that they will find an audience and everyone who has an ear to hear today, whether they're here in person or whether they're listening online. And I pray that it will bring them to repentance. I pray that it will bring them to a place where they worship and honor you and praise you for the freedom and the liberty which you have given to us as the children of God and as your representatives, your ambassadors here in this world, proclaiming the good news about Jesus Christ to each and every person, that we might have the opportunity for our paths and our lives to cross with the path of their lives. And certainly we give you all of the honor and all of the praise and all of the glory for all of the results in the name of our Lord Jesus. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. So as we look at that, I just want to remind you of something very quickly from 2 Corinthians 4:18, which is the scripture that we're basing this entire series upon. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18, it says, "So we fix our eyes on not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." And let's be honest this morning, it's so easy to focus our eyes upon what we can see though, right? It's so much easier to walk by sight than it is to walk by faith. It's so much easier to have the proof of the pudding right before you that you can hold with your hands and look at than it is to have to exercise faith in something that you can't see or something that you can't actually hold in your hands in the present time. And we're all guilty. We're all guilty of walking by sight instead of walking by faith at opportunities or at different times within our life. But we're challenged here today and throughout this whole series of temporary versus eternal to get our eyes off of what we can see and start focusing our eyes upon that which we can't actually see, because that is what is eternal and that is what lasts forever. People say, how can you believe in a God that you can't see? How can you follow a God who says he lives inside of you, but you have no actual evidence of that being so? And how can you continue to put one foot in front of the other each day, walking a pathway of faith, when you don't even know where you're going? And so most of the world is trapped in this ability or in this hindrance of only being able to walk by sight. They can only walk where they can see that their feet are able to go, and they can only do the things that they can see that they're able to do. And yet when you and I walk by faith, and we walk by the power of God's Holy Spirit living inside of us, it's an exciting life. It's a life that, yeah, maybe you don't exactly know what's going to happen 5 minutes from now or 5 years from now or 500 years from now, but you do know what he has promised, and you do know that his faithfulness gives us the confidence that what he has spoken will be absolutely true. Let God be true, and let every man be a liar. The word of God endures forever. The eternal thing that we're going to be looking at the most throughout this series is the very word of God himself. Because heaven and earth will pass away, but the word of the Lord will endure forever. That word holds all of his creation together. That word allows everything that works within the visible world to continue to work the same way that it does each and every day, because the word of the Lord has said so. The sun comes up each and every morning and it runs its course across the sky from east to west, faithfully each and every day, proving to you and I the faithfulness of our God. And he has set in motion throughout all of his creation some reminders of his faithfulness and his almightiness, his magnificence and his power, so that you and I can have confidence and place our faith in something that we can't actually see, but we can certainly have communion with our spirit and his spirit. And if you don't know what I'm talking about there this morning, then I want to challenge you to listen with all of your heart today, because at the end of this message today, I believe that you'll be able to have that opportunity to hear what the Spirit is saying to you if you don't have that ability right now. Amen?
Amen.
Let's get right into the meat of the message. We're going to be looking at Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Now let me give you a little bit of history and background leading into these verses so we can understand the contrast of in which they were spoken and the time in which they were spoken and what was happening in the nation of Israel at that time. Isaiah is a contemporary prophet during the time that the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom are under attack, and the northern kingdom is about to be carried off into captivity by Assyria, and the southern kingdom will eventually be carried off into captivity by the Babylonians. They'll spend 70 years in that captivity, and then they're going to return to rebuild the temple and also to rebuild the walls. We've spoken messages from each of those series in the rebuilding of the wall from the book of Nehemiah, as well as the building of the temple in the book of Ezra. So this is the time period in which we're looking at, a time period that covers some 160 years before Isaiah makes these statements that God places in his heart to say. Why? Because the children of Israel are about to go through some of the toughest 160 years that up to this point they've ever been through. Now, since this time, they've gone through much more. Through World Wars I and World War II and almost the complete annihilation of the Jewish people in the World War II. And so they've gone through much, much more. But at this time, this next 160 years in their existence as a nation would be some of the toughest times that they would ever face. So you say, well then why, Pastor Darrell, are we preaching this message today? Here's why. Because the next few years are going to be the toughest that you've ever faced as a people in the United States of America. It's coming, folks. God wants you to be ready for it. He wants you to be comforted by the fact that he's still in control. He wants you to be comforted by the fact that no matter what takes place, you are still his, and he's still on your side. He still has you in his heart. He still has you in his mind, and he will still give you the strength to endure what is coming. Amen? So be prepared for it. For the nation of Israel, they needed to be prepared for what was coming. So here's the first challenge. Don't look at your current circumstances or your future circumstances. Don't look at God through your current circumstances or your future circumstances. Because we have a tendency to do that. We look at our God through the circumstances of our life. And when we do that, our God becomes small and our God becomes awfully weak, because it seems that in the current, he's not able to deliver me from my circumstances. He's not able to turn my circumstances around and make them better, because we are so short-sighted and because we think that we should have gotten it yesterday. We're an instant gratification society. And so for God to tell you and I that we would have to wait 3 or 4 more years, or like the nation of Israel, 160 years for what God is prophesying to take place to actually happen, we go, oh, I can't do that. I need it yesterday. I need it tomorrow. I am under oppression right now, Lord. Don't you know what's going on in my life, in my marriage, in my job, and in this country? Don't you know the fools who are running this nation right now? And God goes, I know all things. What you don't know is what I know. But I'm about to tell you, he says, to the nation of Israel and to you and I as well, right? So don't look at God through your circumstances, but instead look at your circumstances through a mighty and almighty God. Because then your circumstances are what become small and minuscule, and God becomes huge. So make sure that you're looking at your circumstances with the right perspective, and that you're looking at God with the right perspective as well. In Isaiah chapter 40, beginning in verse 1, he says, "A double comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem." So what is God saying when he says to speak comfortably to a nation that's under attack? A nation that's under attack by the Assyrians and about to be under attack by the Babylonians in a few short years. Right? And a war that would take place over the period of many years, and then they'd be carried off into captivity for 70 years, and then it would take them another 50 years to go back and build the temple and rebuild the walls, and then another 100 and some years after that to be reestablished as a nation. And when you think about that, that's longer than the United States has been a nation. Right? All totaled together from the time that we came over here as New England and the British colonies were planted and they established the 13 colonies. And then we have to remember that the Americas, or what would eventually be the United States of America, was at one time only from the Appalachian Mountains eastward. And then eventually it was from the Mississippi River eastward. And then eventually we were able to expand our borders all the way to the Pacific Ocean. But everything west of the Mississippi at one time was controlled by the Spaniards and the Dutch. Right? And so we had all of these treaties throughout all of the history of the world that eventually made the United States what it is today and the borders that it exists today. And you and I live in a nation that we very sometimes don't even know the history of, or how that we became a nation, or even why God allowed the United States to become a nation. What was his purpose for the United States of America in the focus of the entire world? Why did God allow us to rise to power? Because we can agree upon one thing this morning. God raises up nations and God puts them down. Right? Throughout all of the history of the world, the Assyrians rose as a nation and conquered the northern kingdom of Israel. And then the Assyrians were no more. The Babylonians rose up and they conquered the southern kingdom of Judah. And then the Babylonians were no more. And all throughout the history of the world, God has raised up nations and then put nations down. So he raised up the United States of America for a purpose. If we don't live out that purpose, guess what? He can put us down just as quickly as he rose us up. Amen? So comfort, comfort my people, says your God, and speak tenderly to Jerusalem. And proclaim to her that her hard service or her warfare has been completed. Now, the term for hard service or warfare is severe trials. Anybody been through a severe trial in the last year and a half? Has the nation been through a severe trial in the last year and a half? God speaking to you and I. Amen? Your hardship is over, he says. Now, they declared Michigan to be wide open back on the 22nd of June. And so we don't have to wear masks anymore, except for in the doctor's offices and in nursing homes. Go figure. Right? We were talking about that earlier this morning. He says that their hard service has been completed and her sin has been paid for. That she has received from the Lord's hand double for all of her sins. Now you might think for a moment that God is unjust. If he gave them double for their sins, is it any more harsh than judgment than the sins that were created? No. Because later in Jeremiah and other books it says God gave them less than they deserved. So even when he says that I repaid you double for your sins, he's saying I still didn't give you what you deserved. I was compassionate. I was merciful. I was kind. And I was good even when you were evil. Right? But he says, now your warfare is going to be coming to an end. So what is God saying to you and I just as he was saying to Israel at that time, this is it, that the path ahead is going to be difficult, and encouragement and comfort is needed from God in each and every one of our lives, just like it was for Israel, because of what's coming in the very next few months and few years before the Lord comes for his bride. Amen? Because he's coming. We're going to get to that more here in a minute. So the first voice that we're going to look at is that voice of comfort, or that voice of saying that you've received double for your sins that we just quoted, and that your warfare is over. But that doesn't mean it's over right now, because as he said this to Israel, it would be another 160 years before it was actually over. Now, I don't know how much longer our warfare is going to go on. I don't know how much longer our oppression as a nation is going to go on, but God is declaring today that it's over, just like it was already over. So he can say to Israel 160 years before, it's over, even though it was 160 years before it happened. Because God has no limit of time. You and I are caught in this time of 24-hour days and weeks and months and years, but God is not. He lives in the eternal realm. And so he declares it's over, even though it might take 160 years to manifest itself, or three or four more years in our case to manifest itself. It's over. God says it's over. I'm getting ready to come. I'm getting ready to take my bride out of here, and it is over. And it's time now to hear the second voice, and that is the voice of preparation, or the voice of repentance and providence and rebuilding. Verses 3 through 5. The voice of one calling in the wilderness, in the desert prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the wilderness a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, and every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, and the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all mankind will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken of it. Now what is he saying? He's saying, prepare the way for the Lord, repent and trust. So as he's talking about, in the desert prepare a way for the Lord, make straight in the wilderness a highway for our God. In that day and time, or even in our day and time, if you think about the Olympics or anything else, whenever the Olympics are coming to a country, what do? They work on the infrastructure of the country. They build all brand new roads so the people coming to the Olympics can get there in quick, safe fashion. And whenever a king or a monarch came into the scene back during this time, then they would fill in the valleys and make every place level so that the king and his entourage could arrive safely and on smooth ground and could receive a welcome into whatever providence that they were coming into. So to prepare the way of the Lord means to get all of the crooked things out of your life, get all of the low things out of your life, and to make your heart a highway for the Lord to come into you for salvation and to make you a brand new creation in Christ Jesus, because he's coming soon. So prepare the way through repentance. Repenting of everything that might keep you from his salvation and turning with your whole heart to receive the King. Now we know that the ultimate fulfillment of this passage of Scripture was during the time of John the Baptist. John the Baptist prepared the way for the Lord's first coming. And you and I now, as the church, the bride of Christ, are preparing the way for the second coming of the Lord. Amen? We are his arms and his feet and his mouthpiece here on the face of the earth today. And we are preparing the world for the second coming of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And that first voice, or second voice that this world needs to hear, is the voice of repentance and get rid of the crooked things, straighten out your life with God, get right with God, and become a born-again believer so that when he comes, he will be taking you to his kingdom. Amen? And not exiling you from the kingdom forever and ever. Amen? prepare the way for the Lord through repentance and trusting in his arm of salvation. The glory of the Lord certainly appeared. Jesus was the glory of God. All of the Godhead manifested in a human body. And so the world saw Jesus as he walked the face of this earth for 3.5 years. They saw the glory of God. But there's a day coming soon when every eye will see the glory of the Lord appearing out of the clouds as he comes with the trumpet blast. Amen. The glory of the Lord is going to be revealed to a world that no longer even believes in him. Amen. In 2 Chronicles 6:36, they were probably trusting in what prayer had been prayed by Solomon at the dedication of the temple. And you and I, our body is now the temple of the living God. And when you dedicated this temple, and I hope that's every day in your life, that every day when you get up, you practice Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, and you rededicate this temple as a living sacrifice to God. He gave his life that you and I might become the righteousness of God through him. The least that we can do is present this body as a living sacrifice so that his righteousness can live through you and I. And the rest of the world can see the righteousness and the glory of God lived out inside of his children, those who have already received him into their hearts. Amen. In 2 Chronicles 6:36, Solomon prayed this prayer. He said, if they sin against you, and who has never sinned, you might become angry with them and let their enemies conquer them and take them captive to a foreign land far away or near. And that's exactly what happened to Israel. Exactly what Solomon prophesied when he dedicated the temple happened to the nation of Israel. But in that land of exile, they might turn to you in repentance and pray, we have sinned and done evil and acted wickedly. And if they turn to you with their whole heart and soul in the land of their captivity, and they pray towards the land that you gave to their ancestors, towards this city that you have chosen, and towards this temple that I have built to honor your name, then hear their prayers and their petitions from heaven where you live, and uphold their cause. Forgive your people who have sinned against you. I want you to know this morning that that promise is still true. I want you to know that that prayer is still alive and powerful in the kingdom of heaven, and that they hear the prayers of God's people. Amen? And this prayer that Solomon prayed is still true. Whenever in this temple you sin, but then you turn and you repent and turn to the Lord with your whole heart, he will hear your prayer and he will heal your land. Amen? And he will heal the land in which you live in if the whole land will turn to the Lord once again. Amen? In repentance and in trusting in him, then he will restore and he will establish his righteous kingdom here on this earth. And guess what? The ones that are going to be gone isn't you and I. It's the unrighteous who are going to be gone. They're going to be taken away to a judgment called the Great White Throne, and they're going to be cast into an abyss, an eternal second death, which is an eternal separation from the living God, and the righteous people are going to be left ruling and reigning upon a renewed earth. Amen? This is going to be the home of the righteous in the kingdom of God, because the kingdom and New Jerusalem is going to come down from God out of heaven, and it's going to take over this earth. Amen? In closing, and we won't get through all of this today, so this is going to be continued next week, I want you to look at the voice of promise. In other words, the false gods, the enemies, which have enslaved us and all of the people of the world. And I want you to look at it in comparison to the Word of God in verses 6 through 8. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? That all men are like grass, and all of their glory as the flowers of a field. The grass withers and the flowers fall because the breath of the Lord blows on them. And surely the people are grass. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God stands forever. Do you hear what he's saying? Our fleshly lives, human lives, are like grass. We're here today, we're gone tomorrow. And all the glory of your life is like a fading flower. It's here today, but tomorrow it's not shining any longer. That means that our lives here are temporary. This physical body, this clay jar that we hold this great treasure of the living God inside of, is temporary. It's not going to last forever. One day we're all going to be put in the ground, or the trumpet's going to sound, and we're all going to be out of here, right? One of the two. But for most of us, we're going to see the ground where this physical body is. But the promise is there's not a day that we'll actually die, because we have been made alive forever by the eternal God and by the eternal Word of God, which is the seed which gave us birth. Amen? And we cannot die. So we need not fear the enemies of today. We need not fear our circumstances, because they too are only temporary. God is allowing them for a season to accomplish his purpose of bringing a nation to repentance and to trusting in him once again. And when that purpose has been fulfilled, then those things will be done away with. Amen? You look at the last year and a half and you think, oh, woe is me, and all the conspiracy and all of the evil people that are in government or whatever else that we might think are responsible for everything that has happened. Whether they are or whether they're not isn't the question. The question is, God's allowing it to bring a nation to repentance and a nation back to trusting in him as the one true and living God, because we've made idols and we've made false gods out of everything within this nation. And because we've worshipped him, not in spirit and in truth, but we've worshipped him in spirit only. And when you worship in spirit only, there's all kinds of spirits out there in the spirit world, and without no truth, it's a false fire upon the altar of God. And God says, I want you to repent as a people, and I want you to come back to me. And then I want you to worship me not only in spirit, but I want you to worship me with the truth of my word. Because my word endures forever. It's the only truth that will never fail. It's the only truth that will last for all of eternity. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away, the Lord says. Amen? So he's challenging a nation. He's challenging a people to repent and turn to him with all of their heart, so that he can change everything through that. Amen? He's preparing the way for his coming. For the glory of the Lord to come and set up a righteous kingdom right here on this earth. He's going to sit on the throne of his father David, and he's going to rule the nations with a rod of iron. Amen? And you and I, if we will repent and trust in him, can be a part of that. Get rid of the false fire. Get rid of the false god in your life. Whether that's your houses or things or money or position or power, or whether or not it's the god that you manufactured in your head and in your heart and in your mind that is not the God as he has revealed himself through the truth of his word. Because if the God that you're worshiping is only the God that you imagine him to be and not the God he's revealed himself to be, then you're worshiping a false God. And he's sick of it. And he wants everyone to come back to him, because he loves you with every fiber of his being. He's allowed everything to be so for your benefit. Even the things that are happening now that we don't like very much are being allowed for a purpose that we don't fully yet understand. But it is to bring us to repentance and to trusting in the one true and living and almighty God. He's greater than any other god or supposed god in this world. He is the ultimate potentate. He is the only true King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he's coming soon. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. I know we didn't get through this whole message. There's a lot more to go, but we'll continue it next week. Thank you for allowing us to be your servant. Thank you for allowing the passion that you placed inside of me to come forth. If I got a little bit too loud, I apologize, Lord, but let the words be of comfort. Let them be from my heart to the heart of every person who's listening. Let them be from your heart through my heart to every heart that's listening today. And may they hear what the Spirit is saying to the people and to the world today through your word and through your messenger. And we give you all of the praise and all of the honor and the glory for the results that only you can bring. In the name of our Lord Jesus. And everybody said,
amen.
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 Give him all the thanks because it was his message, not mine.
It was beautiful.
Amen.
As we stand to sing our last song, I just remind you that if you're feeling led to give, the ways to give are on the board behind me and posted on Facebook as well for those of you who are on Facebook. I have one more song for you.
Those days that taught my heart.
just know that you are always there for us, Lord, with your unending love. And we just are so grateful for that, Lord, that you've loved us, that you've taken our sins, and that you continue to provide for us and continue to want us to know you and to grow closer to you. And we just ask for your guidance through that, Lord. We take this message we've been given today and just use it to further our knowledge in you and our strength and our courage in you. Lord, we ask that you would be with us as we go forth today and lead us and guide us this week and bring us back safely the next time that we are together. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Have a wonderful 4th, everyone. Wow. Enjoy whatever fireworks you can get a chance to see, and remember that it's a celebration of independence, right?
So, absolutely.